Siamo quasi, eh?
Ok.
Ho avuto un problema con la password. Siamo quasi, eh?
Ok.
Okay, so good afternoon and welcome to Gianluca Biggi. Thank you for accepting our invitation. So Gianluca holds a PhD in management from the University of Pisa and is currently a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Pisa. He has won a number of awards for his PhD thesis. So it's a great pleasure for us to be here this afternoon with you, Gianluca. And the title of the seminar is The Noxious Consequences of Innovation, What Do We Know? So Gianluca, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Roberta. Good afternoon to everyone. Thanks for being here today. Thanks, Roberta, for having invited me to have a seminar in your in your class. So as you already said, I'm a postdoc at University of Pisa. I hold the PhD in management from University of Pisa, and today I will give you an overview of my research line, research interest, which aims at exploring the nature and the dynamics of innovation. In particular, the focus of my PhD was the chemical industry, and I'm interested in exploring the extent and modalities under which firms react to regulation, in particular environmental regulation, in their corporate and innovative strategies. I used to use patent data as a measure of innovation to proxy innovative behavior of companies or other inventing entities and knowledge flows. During my PhD, I also developed an novel methodology combining the extraction of chemical content from patent documents with computational chemistry to understand the nature and the direction of chemical inventions. So today, as already said, I will give you an overview of my specific research interest, and I will try to connect with some single specific research line of my PhD and on my current work.
Sorry Gianluca, I think somebody's asking something, maybe it's not working.
Okay.
So please, okay. What's the problem? I think Emma Giacomello. Maybe it was just a mistake. Is there any problem?
No, thank you, just a mistake.
Sorry, Gianluca, okay. Interrupting you. Please, go ahead.
Okay, no problem. So, in particular, I'm interested in exploring what is called, and I will give you a sense of what I call, what we call, the dark side of innovation. We start from the assumption that most of the scholarly and also policy attention have been devoted in studying and exploring the role of innovation, technological change for economic competition, economic growth, wealth creation, productivity and efficiency at different levels, at the firm level, at the industry level, and also at the national level. So very important technological and economic and social progresses has been achieved also by relying on technological changes and innovations, but there are still global challenges that remain persistent, as for instance, pollution-driven health crisis, climate change-related disasters, and global inequalities. in particular. And most of those global challenges, global sustainability challenges, can be due to innovation-induced industrial activities. So that's why the interest of my research has been devoted in studying the direction of innovation, just to understand the distribution between positive and negative outcomes of innovation, just to answer to the broad question, who benefits from innovation? So we can here discuss in a more detailed way what we mean for harmful innovation, what are harmful innovation, what are the impact of innovation on different aspects of social and environmental life. In general, we just say that harmful innovation can be product or services that are hazardous in use, so they can cause direct health or environmental hazard, as for instance the case of DDT or glyphosate that we will explore in a more detailed way in the next few slides. Also, harmful innovation can be products that can be hazardous in the production for some social groups, as for instance, if we look at the case of the iPhone or other tech devices that are based on the extraction of minerals in condition of slave labors or child labor, this infringes some human rights. Also, harmful innovation can be technologies that are hazardous for their impact more broadly in society. And some examples are for instance, the job losses that derive or may derive from the automation or the social conflict that can arise from the use of or the exposure to social media. So innovation, as we said, can have harmful impact on rights, in particular rights to health and life, rights to decent work, or rights to land or water. And here we have some example of the infringement, related to the infringement of some basic rights due to innovation and technological changes. The first one that I would like to show you is the case of glyphosate. Glyphosate is the active principle of an herbicide used to kill weeds, and which is that is distributed and produced by Monsanto under the trade name of Roundup. The glyphosate, or in general the Roundup, is a very common and widespread used chemicals. And since 2019, it has been classified by the International Agency for the Research on Cancer, the IARC, as probably cancerogenic to humans. Another example of human rights infringement of technologies can be related to the right to decent work. And this is the case of technological devices that strongly depends on minerals. In particular, if we look at the mineral like coltan are extracted through the use of slave labor and child labor. And in this case, but also in other cases, it's barely impossible to have a clean value chain. I mean, a value chain free from slave labor or other polluting, environmental polluting activities. Another example is the right to water and land. In particular, this is the case where extractive industries works around indigenous communities that can be deprived from their lands or some access to clean water can be denied. And this can be a source of environmental of some environmental conflict that may arise. So by looking at this quite short overview of some impact that some innovation, some technologies can have on different aspects of social life, but also the impact of technologies on the environment or the ecosystems in general, the question that can be arise can be how hazard is defined, by whom, and why. So the hazard can be defined based on the experience, and this is the case of the asbestos or other polluting chemicals or materials that result in health crises and environmental damages, but also by scientific research that is also based on experience. And this is also the case of tobacco and junk food and so on. Also, there are social groups that can be interested in assessing or give information on the noxious impact of some technologies, some products, and so on. And also there is the case of regulators, as in the case for the glyphosate, the International Agency for the Research on Cancer, that based on scientific evidence classify chemicals or other kind of of product as carcinogenic or in general hazardous for human health or the environment. So most of the existing research in economics, also in management, but also the policy attention, especially in industrialized economies, emphasize the role or the bright side or the upsides of technological changes, and sometimes overlooks the social and environmental downside. And we think that looking also at the negative aspects, the downside of technological changes is innovation, is an important issue to tackle sustainability, challenges. So today I would like to show you a recently published articles called The Noxious Consequences of Innovation, What Do We Know, which is my first work, my first scientific work as a PhD, co-authored with Elisa Giuliani from University of Pisa, which tried to make sense of the existing literature on the human and environmental downsides of innovation. In particular, we are interested in not only to make sense of the existing literature, but to identify the research communities, the research scholarly communities that are active in studying and exploring the dynamics, the antecedents of harmful innovation. We used the bibliometric approach to have, and I think that the bibliometric approach, the bibliometric technique, which I'm going to introduce in the next few slides, can also be useful for you, for your research, also if you are looking to a specific topic for your dissertation or for some class assignment during your course. So by using this systematic approach that I'm going to introduce, we provide the literature on the topic of the negative impact of innovation, and we try to identify the dominant research topics within this area of inquiry, and also the intellectual pillars. So the main theories that are used from the scholar interested in the social and environmental downsides of innovation. Here we have in this slide there is explained also, even though in a stylized fact, the bibliometric approach. Bibliometrics typically rely on some softwares. Most of them are freely available software. For this paper, we use an R package that is called Bibliometrics and BiblioShiny. These are two packages that are freely available through the CRAN repository. But independently of the package or the software you use for your bibliometric mapping, for your bibliometric literature review, the starting point is the search through the databases, as for instance we use in this case Scopus, and we tried to download all the articles dealing with the noxious consequences of innovation. So we prepare a query by combining all the possible combination of innovations, technologies, and the negative aspect that can be related to technologies, so environmental problems, environmental health crisis. These are just some example, which also you can find that maybe at the end of the seminar, I can share with you the article where in the appendix there is a long search query which we used to identify and to find all relevant articles dealing with the topic we are interested in. Then we used the bibliometric software as I also introduced to try to map and to create some clusters related to this research topic. In particular, we rely on two bibliometric techniques that are the most widely used if you are interested in understanding and detecting the different research sub-communities and the intellectual pillars of a specific strand of research. But you have here in this slide, you can also see that you have many options if you decide to use bibliometric approach to perform a systematic review of a specific topic, because maybe you can be more interested in assessing or looking the evolution of some terms, some keywords over time related to a topic you are interested in. In our work, we use the two techniques that I'm going to very briefly introduce to you, in particular bibliographic coupling and the co-citation analysis. So the bibliographic coupling, as you can see here in these slides, try to couple two documents that refer to a common work. And this is used to identify different research sub-communities based on the assumption that if two documents cite the same set of references, they are more likely to belong to the same research community. On the contrary, we used also co-citation analysis that couple documents that are cited together by a document. And this technique is particularly useful to detect the most relevant papers, the most influential or seminal papers used by the different sub-communities. In the next slide, I will show you also some examples related to our sample of articles dealing with the negative impact of innovation. Here we have what I already said. So the co-citation analysis is useful to understand the intellectual antecedents of a given strand of scholarly research, while the bibliographic coupling connects documents that cite the same set of references, and it is useful to detect the research sub-communities dealing with a specific topic. So from the search that involved the use of Scopus and the combination of keywords I have already introduced to you, we noted an increasingly scholarly attention over time, especially in the next few years, looking at the negative aspect, the human health or environmental downside of innovation. And this creates the space, give us the motivation to try to make sense of this literature and to understand better the different scholarly tradition dealing with this topic. In particular, these are the result of the bibliographic coupling analysis. So basically, here we have five, because we detected mainly five research strands dealing with this topic. We labeled each, this is based on a cluster analysis as a result of the bibliographic coupling. And we named each research sub-community with a label that represent, in a sense, the specific topic or subtopic looking at the negative impact of innovation. In particular, as I said, we identified five clusters. The first cluster, which is the most prominent in the number of articles, we called the work-related consequences of technology acceptance. And in this cluster, there are articles looking at the adverse consequences, the negative impact of the adoption of ICTs within the organizations. So in these clusters, there are articles, just to give you an example, but in the paper, there are a lot, looking at, for instance, the psychological effect of the adoption from employees of a certain technology within an organization, the impact on job satisfaction and on turnover intention within the organization. The second cluster, this cluster are ordered in based on the number of articles they include. So cluster A is the cluster that that involves the higher number of article in our sample. Cluster B we called unsustainable transitions, and here in these clusters there are articles dealing with the negative effect of innovation and their interaction between the social, economical, and institutional environment, and these are mostly transition scholars interested in the transition toward sustainability, and in particular interested in why some innovation takes an unsustainable fashion, and in particular here I remember the article of Inger Opke related to the unsustainable directionalities of some ICT technologies and why they took and in this paper there is explained why they took those unsustainable fashion. Then cluster C, which we called innovation and growth and downside effect, there are articles mainly from the economic literature, and they look at the negative and side effect of innovation from a macro level perspectives, and they look at the impact of technological changes on the social and the economic environment. As one of the examples we already made is the impact of the adoption of automation and other technologies on unemployment and on inequalities, for instance. So this is the third cluster, the third cluster looking at those dynamics. Then we have a cluster D, which we called the dangers of emerging technologies. And in this cluster, there are several articles looking at the potential dangers of some emerging technologies, for instance, the impact of nanotechnologies and their implication in terms of ethics, responsibilities, and looking at also to the role of policies to keep up with industry development. Then cluster E, which is the smallest in terms of articles, we call the open innovation dark side, and look at the negative consequences of the adoption of open innovation within firms. So this way, by using the bibliographic coupling, we were able to have an idea of the different communities looking at different perspectives, using different research methods and different levels of analysis that deal with the general topic of the dark side, the negative effect of innovation. So from this kind of analysis, we have the possibility to have an idea on the different communities working on this general topic, and we know that some scholars are interested in the effect of the adoption of some ICTs within the organization, while others are more interested in macroeconomic effect of the adoption of automation or other technologies on employment and inequalities and so on. Then, based on the bibliographic coupling, we tried to look at the different theories that inspires that can be linked to the different clusters we detected from the bibliographic coupling analysis. So just to give you an idea, cluster B, which we called unsustainable transition, rely mainly to transition theory and transition management, while cluster C, which is the more interested in the economic or macroeconomic effect of the adoption of some technologies, rely on evolutionary economic theories and related management theories. While cluster D, which is the more focused on the role of emerging technologies in society, look at the business ethics literature and on responsible research and innovation. Just to conclude, and then I will move to the connection with this first attempt to map the scientific research dealing with the topic of the negative impact of innovation. So we observe that there is an increasing scholarly attention to the downsides of innovation. But we have separate, but we observed also that the different scholarly agendas, the different scholarly communities work as a separate field of inquiry. So there is not a single field of research, but each sub-community works using different perspectives, different approaches, and also different theories. So also there are different intellectual traditions around the communities we identified. So for this reason, and that's why this was my first approach to this topic, is to identify also, given the fact that this topic seems to me interesting and a promising area to do some research, I identified also some gaps, in particular gaps related to the methodologies to measure noxious inventions, to predict maybe the impact of innovation on different aspects of life. And also there is a gap related to the role of companies and their strategic decision in shaping the direction of innovation. So to connect to my research lines, I elaborate some, these are the articles or the chapters or the part of my PhD thesis, which try to focus on the chemical sector, because in the chemical sector, there is a lot of space of dark innovations. And in particular, with the patent toxicity articles, we developed a methodology to assess the potential noxious impact of chemical patent or chemical technologies or chemical inventions. And by relying on this methodology, that maybe if some of you have some curiosity, we can talk a bit on those measures. I can share with you the paper, or we can discuss a bit in a more detailed way. Then also by relying, as I said, on those methodologies, I also had the opportunity to study, to explore the geography of dark innovation or harmful innovation. So the spread across countries of toxic invention, and also to test in particular which is the focus of my PhD thesis, the reaction at the corporate level to the environmental regulation in terms of innovative strategies. So the way companies do chemical patents, if the patenting behavior changes across countries and within the organization, so the difference between certain kind of organizational structure and their impact on the way firms do their chemical patents. And now there are also ongoing collaboration. In particular, these are the most recent. In particular, we are going to explore the role of inventor teams within companies in terms of toxic patents and so on. And also we are trying to enlarge our research also not only to the chemical agrochemical industry, but also to the broader area of chemistry, meaning also soap, paints, fibers, and so on. So I think I should stop here and leave the floor to curiosities, questions, clarification, and so on. I don't know, Roberta, if I'm in time.
Yeah. So thank you very much. Very, very interesting. A lot of interesting insight, and I suppose also a lot of questions, because I mean, it's a very novel topic. So I have a number of questions, but both the students here and who is participating from home can ask a question. You can use the chat, but you can also open your microphone. And I don't know if there are questions from here. Otherwise, I can also start with some questions, and maybe some more questions will follow. And if you want, you can also ask a question in Italian, I think. Gianluca.
Okay.
Okay, now my first question is about the bibliographic analysis, and I was you didn't tell us if you have defined some way the scientific disciplines in which you have undertaken the analysis. So I wonder if it's just social sciences, or maybe also a subsection of social sciences. I think this is because I suppose that if you open up to chemistry, it's becoming quite complicated, no?
Okay, right, Roberta, sorry, I forgot to clarify on this point. We limited the search to social sciences, so we included sociology, management, business, accounting, and economics, but we exclude physics, chemistry, mathematics, computer science, and so on.
Yeah, and I have another question also in relation. I mean, not so related, but I wonder if you have explored also the geographic focus of the literature. So, for instance, if the focus, at least for the more empirical works, the focus is more on developed countries, in developing countries, and maybe related with this, you can tell us something also about your new work on the geography of patent toxicity, but you were saying that it's just submitted to regional studies. I think, the focus of our course is on innovation and development. So it will be interesting to know a little bit more about the, how much the developing countries are involved in the literature and also in terms of patent toxicity.
Okay. Thank you for the question. So, as for the articles included in the sample, I have no exact idea where they come from. There is a possibility to look and to dig into these details, as in the bibliographic records there are authors affiliation, journal affiliation, so we can have an idea on the different strands where are more likely to occur and to explode, but we didn't for the literature review analysis. We did for the geographical dynamics of toxic patents, which is the regional studies, which is the regional studies paper. And in this sense, we observe that over the recent years, I mean, especially from 2010 onwards, toxic inventions are more likely to occur in developing countries. Even though the supranational regulation aimed at protecting human beings and the environment also is enforced in those countries. So over time, what we observe is that from 1950, 1970 till 2000, there is a geography of toxic chemicals around Europe and the United States. And we observe also a shift, so a reduction of toxic invention from developed country to developing countries. Probably, and this is the result also of some interviews we did with some industry expert, is mostly due to the lack of enforcement in the regulation within countries. Also, we under the Rotterdam Convention, there are country-level reports on the status of implementation of the regulation related to the toxic chemicals, and we observed that in countries as Indonesia, Vietnam, Cambodia, and so on, there is like a secondary market for those products. So the monitoring around toxic chemicals is quite difficult and impossible to manage.
So somehow this is confirming the fact that I mean, maybe multinationals are moving to these countries to deal with the more toxic product because of the regulation in the advanced countries.
Yeah.
Something that the literature has emphasized for quite a long time. So I wonder if there are questions here or at home.
I was just
You have to come down because otherwise you have to come down and ask your question from here because otherwise from home they will not understand. Sorry? Vabbè, fa niente, però nessuno, se no nessuno sente nulla. Please.
I just want to ask you, maybe I missed and you already said, but I was asking if bibliometrica is free and is executable on normal computers.
Yes, it's most of the software you can you can use to do your bibliometric analysis are freely available. Some are quite difficult in a sense that, as for the case of bibliometrics, that is the software we used, you just need some basics of R, while others are web interfaces. So you can just upload your set of articles you are interested in, and you can use the web interface to draw clusters, to see the evolution of keywords and other patterns within your sample. So they are freely available, most of them, and you can run it on a normal computer. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
More questions? Any of you is following the data analysis course and you're still using R?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, no, because we use for the economic course, we use Stata, but there is a course in data analysis, and I know that they learn how to use, the students learn how to use R. So, you know, already a little bit. More questions? Or also Tom, questions? No more questions? Come on. So I will ask a question that maybe could be of interest for more people. I think it will be it will be interesting to have some ideas at least about your methodology to assess toxicity. And yes. Also, I wanted to ask you a question which I think maybe is related. So, for instance, when a company or an inventor would like to patent some kind of chemical products in the application and for the patent to be given, there is not any kind of assessment about toxicity. So if I invent something which is toxic and I go and ask a patent, I will be given a patent without any kind of
restrictions or
possible toxicity and limitation also about how to use this patent somehow.
Okay, so let me start if I can to with the second point. So as for the patenting process of toxic chemicals compound included in the patent, as well as for the case of regulated, so chemical compounds that are restricted or prohibited in use, in trade, and so on, there is no limitation in the patenting processes, in a sense that during the patent application, no one is in charge of looking at the toxicity as well as the inclusion of some regulated chemicals within the invention. So the patenting process is not involved in this way. The regulation goes on products that eventually can be distributed and traded. For the methodology, I'm trying to, because the explanation of the methodology to assess patent toxicity require a quite long time to be explained, but just to be to keep it simple as as much as I can, each chemical patent is composed by a list of chemical compounds, that is the chemical formulation of the substance that is the object of the patent protection. So we have a patent that is a document that legally protects a chemical technology. The chemical technology is composed by a list of chemical compounds that are disclosed in terms of chemical identifiers as cast numbers, I and K or SMILES, that are international standards for the identification of specific chemical compounds. And our methodology to assess the toxicity of chemical inventions rely basically on two steps. The first is the extraction of the chemical content from patents. So we have, for instance, a patent that is linked to a list of chemical compounds. And also the patent is linked to a company and other information related to the patent assignee. The chemical compounds are evaluated by using quasar models that are computational chemistry tools. And we use the same tools used by the European Chemical Agency to assess human environmental toxicity of chemical compounds. And once we have the result of the toxicity by using the models compound by compound, we collapse the toxicity result at the compound level. So we elaborate different indicators as, for instance, the number of human health toxic compounds disclosed in the patent over the total number of compounds disclosed in the patent, or the concentration like an Erfindahl index to see whether the toxicity of the chemical technology described in the patent is due to a single compound or multiple compounds. So basically there is on the one hand the extraction of the chemical content, and on the other hand the evaluation through the quasar models of the properties of the single compounds. And then we collapse the result at the patent level by using different indicators.
No, that's very interesting. And so do you think that a similar technique could be used? As far as I could understand, in terms of chemical compounds, is relatively easy because you have all the information about the toxicity of these different chemical components. But if I want to move to different type of category of patent, probably is becoming much more complicated, no?
Yeah, probably. So computational chemistry technique are no longer useful in this case. Probably the way to assess toxicity can be the text, a kind of text analysis, because the mechanism of the chemical extraction and the quasar modeling, the computational chemistry modeling, is like there is a text, there are chemical information, we read those information. In other fields, for instance, electronics or artificial intelligence or other technical domains, probably the way to assess toxicity or the negative impact of invention can be the text analysis. So by using topic modeling, block modeling, and other tools and other related tools.
Yeah, that's quite interesting. So questions from here or from home? You can ask a question in Italian if you feel more relaxed or confident. Nothing? So I have another question. I would like to ask you is if you can give us some example about, I think what was your last category, open innovation, dark side. What do you mean by that? I was, what kind of dark side could have open innovation?
Okay, as far as I remember, in that cluster, there are mostly case studies on the negative impact of the adoption of open innovation strategies at the company levels, at the company level in terms of revenues, performance, and other kind of economic or financial results. So
not impact on the environment, but more on the
corporate level.
Okay. And something else I wanted to ask you. I think when you explain the theory behind the different clusters, you didn't tell us anything about the first cluster, and there were some strange theories. So just to have an idea.
Okay, right. So
I have a theory of reason and action. I don't have any idea what it is. So if you can just give us an idea.
Okay, so just to be general, because I'm not an expert
an insight or an intuition.
Okay, in this cluster, since they look at the psychological effect of the adoption of certain ICT technologies, they rely on psychological theories. So theory of reason and action and the technology acceptance model are theories most that stems from the psychology, let's say, psychology pool.
But now I remember that you were making some example about the psychological out and this kind of thing. So okay, but I didn't connect the two things. Okay, yeah, now it's clear. Okay, so nothing has come to your mind? Here is very silence and then Tom too. So I think, I would like to thank you very much. I think it will be nice, but I think I can also find myself the article because I can share this article with everybody because I think it's really, it could really also useful in terms of thinking about using this kind of methodologies, for instance, for a thesis. I think it will be, of course, One key point when you do this bibliometric analysis is to define very, very well what is the objective of your analysis, because otherwise could become, sometimes if you identify with some keywords, you are reaching maybe thousands and thousands of results. So you need the identification of keywords is really crucial. So for instance, it will be interesting, if you are interested in this methodology, it will be interesting to have a look at the kind of keywords they have used. Because if the keywords are wrong, it can be really a problem because you will not get anything. So this is somehow it seems easy, but on the other side it's very difficult to identify and to define the objective of what you want to do. But it's somehow also, if you use it well, it's I would say that it's a nice and quite effective way of doing a thesis, for instance. I don't know what you think, Gianluca.
No, sure. That's why I use the some slide to have an idea. And also, if you wanted to share with the students, I think they capture the very basic steps to perform a bibliometric analysis. I think it's quietly costly in terms of learning how to use the software, but once you acquire the skills to perform a bibliometric analysis, you can do for every topic you are interested in. So you can start for the thesis, and then you can use it also if you need to do other research and so on. So and also one of the advantages is that you don't need to look at article by article, but if you perform a fine-grained query, you apply the correct filters as you mentioned. So by looking at social sciences, or if you are more interested in the management literature or the economic literature, you can also have a map of a topic without looking at the single articles, but you can just keep the focal articles within each cluster and to have a sense of the community. So you can also reduce the workload that on the contrary you have to do by looking article by article.
Sure. Yeah. Okay, so I think we can thank you very much, Gianluca. Yeah, I think it was very, very, very interesting, and thank you for your availability. And I mean, good luck with your work. Okay. Ciao Gianluca.
Grazie Roberta. Alla prossima. Buona giornata.
Ciao ciao.